Welcome back to 2GB's special tribute to John Pierce.
1967.
Good morning, Vietnam!
Australian soldiers were fighting in Vietnam. Others took to the streets protesting the war. It was the era of sex, drugs and rock and roll, of feminism, the Beatles and television. It was also the year that one cranky moment on air from John Pierce turned radio on its ear. Kel Richards takes up the story.
When talkback finally came to Australian radio in the 1960s, it was decided by the management of 2GB to get rid of Andrea, who'd been doing a chat show, and replace her with John doing open line. When he started, he did the open line the way he used to do interviews, in a kind of self-effacing way, drawing out the person who was calling on the end of the line and being really chatty and really nice to them. Then one day he came in not a very good mood. I don't know whether he'd had a bad oyster or whatever the excuse was, but he got really cranky and did his lolly with the listeners. After he came off the air, the manager at the time, bloke named Des Foster, called him into his office, and John, as the way John told the story to me, he said, "Oh, I'm for it." Des called him in and said, "Terrific, mate. Keep that up." And that was the secret from then on.
Don't let a few facts get in the road of your bias, will you? Because I said so. Now, that's the second time I've told you. Why don't you let them do it and mind your own damn business? Take women, for instance. They cheat. Oh, even that you mucked up. Good grief.
Anyway.
Well, you're a bit of a dill, aren't you? Absolute rubbish.
Well, I'm not dribbling. I mean, you're advertising.
If I say you're dribbling, you're dribbling, sir. Well, what are you talking about? Firstly, I don't believe it.
Do you really run a business and you're as stupid as this?
We've got to get this right.
What made you say that?
Stop making a fool of yourself and drop the phone back into the thing. Do you drink alcohol?
No, I don't.
Why the hell don't you?
Wrong.
I'd like to say I think you should go and see a psychiatrist.
There's a subtle snigger. Garbage. Absolute rubbish.
You've got a brilliant brain.
That'd be true. What a miserable character you must be. Absolute rubbish.
John, of course, then, started his own program, and it was a feisty program. He wanted to make it feisty. He wanted to make it entertaining but argumentative, so that a lot could come out, a lot of argument for and again and everything else. And he took a risk by being rude to people, but people loved it. They loved all that knockabout stuff. It was like going to a prize fight.
Because I said so. Now, that's the second time I've told you. Don't let a few facts get in the road of your bias. Oh, even that you mucked up. Good grief.
Mind your own damn business.
Absolute rubbish.
Anyway.
Well, you're a bit of a dill, aren't you? If I say you're dribbling, you're dribbling, sir.
Do you really run a business and you're as stupid as this?
I think you should go and see a psychiatrist.
Why the hell don't you?
Wrong.
Garbage. There's a subtle snigger. Absolute rubbish.
Sorry if I said something and offended you.
Former 2GB executive Des Foster says John Pierce was born to be a radio talkback host.
As a matter of fact, when we started talk radio in the 60s, an American broadcaster had told me that in the whole of the United States, there were probably only about a dozen really outstanding talk radio people. He was making the point that they're very hard to find, people with those special talents. And John was one of those in the early days who really had that instinct for talk radio and for talk back in particular. And I often think, you know, that for all of the publicity that Andrea got of those days, because she was an outstanding personality, and not in any way to detract from her, the fact of the matter is she was a team with John Pierce. They never could have had the ratings they did if it hadn't been for the part that John played.
Former colleague Ted Harris.
John became one of the most prominent broadcasting personalities, and he was an integral part of the 2GB team that dominated commercial broadcasting for a very long period of time.
I mentioned earlier how John Pierce and I would sit in our garage, two beds and one shared wardrobe, in the guest house in Hobart and discuss our dreams and our hopes for the future in 1950. I can't remember now what either of us had in mind. Certainly we never envisaged the courses our lives were to take. In 1950, radio was the only electronic media entertainer. It was the coming of television that gave us both the boost we yearned for. The experts, of course, believed that the small live picture box would put an end to radio and the movie houses. How wrong they were. Certainly the big production shows on radio had to convert to TV or fall by the wayside, but radio early on found a new audience, the teenager, rock and roll, pop music for the kids. And with that, my career became upwardly mobile, as we said. I became a disc jockey. It was Brisbane. I remember telling the station manager that I was a disc jockey. And I can still remember the shocked expression. A what? He said, our listeners will think you ride horses. I persevered, thankfully. My newfound home of Brisbane became very good to me. My fellow dreamer, John Pearce, had to wait a little longer before finding his true forte. He was happily employed from 1954 at 2GB as producer, anchorman. He was part of a talk team that dominated the morning ratings. Eric Bohm, Andrea, Dieter Cobb, Gwen Plum, Gordon Chater. But in 1967, radio discovered a new concept. The government of the day licensed broadcasters to use a technical facility which, by the use of a tape loop, delayed any phone calls by 7 seconds before going to air. A vital 7 seconds in which the host could decide whether the subject was either slanderous or obscene. Yes, talkback radio was born. I poo-pooed its potential. Who wanted to hear Mr. and Mrs. Suburbia airing their views when you could get the same thing every evening over the back fence? All right, so we all make mistakes, like the man who refused to sign the Beatles in 1963. It is now part of legend that John Pearce found his true métier when he lost his temper with that little old lady, the silly old Chook. So was born Insult Radio. It seemed incredible at the time, but there was an audience out there that was happy to be insulted, and plenty more who loved to listen to it. But the put-down was only a part of the John Pearce show. He knew how to structure a program so that he was arrogant one minute, smart aleck the next, but always entertaining, and that's how he saw himself, as an entertainer.
He set out with his radio programs to entertain, and that was what the man was about, entertainment, which is so much missing from today's busy, rushing world, entertainment, and that summed him up, an entertainer.
John Pearce really was larger than life. He really was a character.
Like the chap who came up to me and said, do you believe in clubs for women? And I said, yeah, but only if kindness fails.
Oh, you're a funny man.
He was one of these blokes who had always heard the latest joke before you had and told it better than anyone else.
I remember meeting a Scotsman once, and he said, oh dear, I wish I knew where and when I was going to die. And I said, why? And he said, I wouldn't turn up.
And because he was larger than life, I ended up using him as a character in two of my novels. I was writing a couple of detective novels set in a radio station, one called The Second Death and one called The Third Bloodstain. And if you look at those, you'll find there is a character in them by the name of Jack Kingston. That is John Pearce. He's still there, preserved in fiction.
Coming up next... Classic John Pearce.
Wrong.
Right.
Wrong.
Ask the expert.
I am an expert.
This is a special tribute to John Pearce on 873 2GB.